We'll start now. Good evening, everyone. Today we are going to yet another OSCE series of IAP Kozhikode, that the ODC Road to Success. So today we have an interesting session by Dr. Abdul Rauf. So I think many of you would be familiar with Dr. Abdul Rauf. He's a pediatric intensivist in Baby ML Hospital, and he has done his MD from MPJ Chandigarh and FNB pediatric critical care from Gangaram Hospital. And he is one of the few pediatric intensivists who has done fellowship in ECMO. So he's a very excellent teacher, and he has plenty of publications to his name. And it's a privilege to introduce my colleague and pediatric intensivist, Dr. Abdul Rauf. So he'll be speaking on ABG and also on ventilator graphics. And also there is a few more potpourris which he'll be very interesting to share with all of you. So welcoming everyone to the sessions. Over to Dr. Rauf.
Thank you, Dr. Raji. So I thank IAP Kozhikode for this opportunity, and I thank all my students for the feedback given for the past sessions. So okay. So today we will be discussing topics like ventilator graphics, followed by arterial blood gas analysis, and if time permits, I will be talking about acute COVID in children and also MISC if time allows. Okay, so these are topics, graphics and ABG, which needs some time to understand. So I will be going slow, and I will be covering the theory part followed by the exercise part. So I request all of you to keep a paper and a pen with you. And you don't need to take notes because the YouTube link will be shared, but that is just to do the exercise and be prompt in answering in the Zoom chat box. And that is to keep you engaged, and I will be giving breaks in between so that it's not very hurried, it's not in a hurried manner. Okay, so here we go. So first topic will be ventilator graphics. So the outline of graphics talk will be a description of the basic waveforms, the scalars, loops, and some specific conditions. Okay, so graphics, I won't be explaining in very detail. I will be teaching just the basics so that it will be helpful for you in your practice, as well as it will be helpful for you to solve some OSCE questions if at all they are asked. I think in a few years back, there were questions about ventilator graphics. So graphics, an introduction. So it's a modern ventilators incorporate graphic displays in their interfaces, which are instantaneous display of pressure, flow, and volume. This allow the clinicians for real-time measurement of patient-ventilator interaction. So it can provide insight to the patient's mechanics of breathing and alert clinician to abnormalities even before the clinical signs are obvious. For example, when you are ventilating an asthma patient, even before the bronchospasm is evident in your ABG, and then even before that, you can detect in the graphics. Especially when there is a leak going, you can detect it very fast, very easily, and very faster in the using the graphics. So by the end of this talk, you should be able to determine the basic abnormalities using the graphics. Okay, so why learn? What is the fun in learning these graphics? So you can identify the mode of the ventilation. You can identify leaks, identify bronchospasm, auto PEEP, changing compliance, work of breathing, asynchronies. You can detect over distension. What is the PEEP given, triggering? So all this information you can get from the graphics. So what are the types of the waveform? So basically there are two types of waveform: scalars and the loops. Okay, so mainly there are three variables: pressure, flow, volume. Okay, so any of these variable plotted against time, so that gives you the scalars. So it could be either pressure time scalar, flow time scalar, or volume time scalar. Now, any of these variables plotted between each other, that gives you loops, that is pressure volume loop, flow volume loop. Okay, clear. So what are the types of waveform? That is the shapes of waveform you can see. So basically, there are six basic waveforms. One is rectangular. The example you can see here, rectangular or square waveform. Now, descending ramp waveform, so that you can see in the flow, descending ramp waveform. Now, there are ascending ramp waveform, sinusoidal waveform, again you can see it in the flow waveform, exponential rising, exponential decaying. So don't need to get confused, just remember there are two type of pressure waveform, that is square waveform and ascending type of waveform. Flow waveform, remember three type, one is sinusoidal, one is this is square waveform, and this is decelerating waveform. So you remember these shapes. So what are the common features of scalars? So scalars, as I already mentioned, there are two axes, x-axis and y-axis. So in y-axis, there will be either volume, flow or pressure, and in the x-axis, it will be time, symbol. Okay. So just what you do, this is a very important information. What you need to remember is the inspiratory, there are two phases of breath, right? One is inspiratory phase, other is expiratory phase. So see here, this is the inspiratory phase. So inspiratory phase is active, means that is led by the ventilator. So this is affected by the modes of ventilation. So if you want to detect the mode of ventilation, you have to look at the inspiratory phase. Okay. So the expiratory phase is always passive, that is done by the patient. So if you want to see the patient's characteristic, you have to look at, for example, the resistance, airway resistance, bronchospasm, even complaints, you have to look at the expiratory waveform. So this is the most important concept. Okay. So here I ask a question, which is the mode of ventilation where expiration is also active? That is where expiration is also done by the ventilator. So you can answer in the chat box. Very good. So many people have answered. I'm very happy to see that. So it is high frequency oscillatory ventilation. So in high frequency oscillatory ventilation, expiration is also active. So all other conventional modes of ventilation, expiration is passive. That is done by the patient alone. Very good. So now we move to flow time scalars. Okay. So y-axis, there is the flow. X-axis, there is the time. So now see the shape of the waveform. This is inspiration, this is sinusoidal waveform, and expiration is always decelerating waveform, because this will be always same, because it is by the patient, it won't change with the mode of ventilation. So this sinusoidal waveform is seen in spontaneous breathing. Okay. Now coming to pressure mode of ventilation. So we're talking about flow time scalars. Okay. See, again, see the expiration, it will be the same, whatever may be the mode of ventilation. Now in pressure mode, what you get is a decelerating flow. We have a set pressure. So the pressure rises very fast to the peak inspiratory flow, and then it decreases. So this is called a decelerating flow pattern, which is seen in pressure mode, pressure control mode or pressure mode. Okay. So the expiration will be the same. Now coming to volume control mode. So just remember flow. What is flow? Flow is volume by time. Flow is volume divided by time. So if the inspiratory time is for a set inspiratory time in volume control mode, so the volume will be constant, right? So the flow will be also constant. So flow is always, practically it is like a synonymous with volume. You just remember like that. So in volume control, you get square waveform. Square waveform means it is constant flow. So square stands for constant flow. So remember, so this is the beginning of the inspiration. Flow rises to rapidly to the peak, and there will be a constant flow. Okay, here inspiration ends. Now in flow, in volume control mode, there will be an end inspiratory pause where there is no flow. So after the end inspiratory pause, expiratory valve opens and expiration happens. So this is expiration, again the same in all waveform. So look at this waveform. So this is, so flow time waveform in volume control will be its constant flow, that is square wave, right? We'll be revising this, don't worry. So we saw flow time wave, flow time scalars in different modes. Now we go to pressure time scalar. Okay, so right, see, so in pressure time scalar, we know that the flow time will be decelerating flow. So again, so what happens in the pressure, in the pressure time scalar is in a pressure control mode. So this is pressure control mode. In pressure control mode, there will be rapid, because you see, there's a rapid flow given. So there will be a rapid increase in pressure. Then pressure control means constant pressure, right? Then it is like a rectangular waveform, or it is like a square waveform. So then it reaches a peak inspiratory pressure, and from here expiration starts. Okay, so you can see there is a the pressure is starting above a baseline. So what does this baseline stand for? This is the peep which we have set. Okay, so for example, this is zero. We have set a peep of 5. So the pressure waveform is starting from 5. Now it is square waveform, because in a pressure control mode, then it decelerates. Now you can see a negative deflection here. So what does this indicate? So this indicates that before the next breath, the patient took a effort. So it was detected as a negative deflection. So this indicated triggered breathing or assisted breathing. Okay, so this is a triggered breath. This negative deflection indicates triggered breath. So square waveform in pressure control. So it is pressure mode. Now we come to, so you look here. This is the flow time scalar in a volume control. So this, I told you, square means this is a constant flow, volume control. So in volume control, what happens? So see the pressure time scalar. So at the start of inspiration, gradually we are giving a constant flow. So gradually the pressure builds up like this ascending ramp. And I told you there will be an inspiratory hold in volume control. So when we hold the inspiration, so I will explain it in a better way. So imagine this is a balloon, and this is a stick which is connected to it, and we are inflating the balloon. Okay, so we are giving flow to the balloon. We surpassed the connector, then we started inflating the balloon. So at the end of inspiration, we measure the pressure here. So that pressure will be the peak inspiratory pressure. So this is the total pressure which was needed to overcome the stroke and the balloon. Okay, now, so this is PIP, total pressure needed to overcome the stroke and balloon. Now you put a hold here when there is no flow state. So then we will be measuring the pressure in the lungs only or the balloon only. So that will be the plateau pressure. So this is the plateau pressure or the lung pressure. And the pressure for this is the trans airway pressure. So this is plateau pressure, trans airway pressure, and the total pressure will be peak inspiratory pressure. So peak inspiratory pressure, when you hold the inspiration, it comes to plateau pressure. Okay, and after the inspiratory hold, expiration starts. For we can have enough time to, we have enough time today, so you can ask any doubts. I will be happy to answer, don't worry. Okay, now coming to volume time scalar. Okay, so we saw the pressure time scalar in pressure mode and volume mode. Now we go to volume time scalar. So there is no much confusion here. Okay, so this is, so volume time scalar only in volume control mode, when there is an inspiratory hold, it will be like this. Otherwise, in a pressure mode, volume curve will be like this. Okay. So now we just summarize what we have learned now. So coming to pressure mode. So to identify the mode, always look at the flow waveform. So this is the notation for flow. So always look at the flow waveform. So this is decelerating flow. So it is pressure mode, right? So in pressure mode, the pressure waveform will be square. So square stands for constant. Just remember like that. Okay, fine. Now you come to the volume mode. The volume is constant, means flow is constant. So it is, flow is square. There is a volume control mode. I told you there is an inspiratory pause. See the pressure waveform. It will be ascending waveform, and there will be an inspiratory pause. You get peak inspiratory pressure, plateau pressure, and trans airway pressure, right? So what are the uses of, now we go to the uses of these graphics. Now what are the uses of flow time scalar? So just see here. So this white one was the normal flow time scalar. Now, in one disease, it has gone pathological. So the peak expiratory flow has decreased and there is some resistance and the expiration is happening in a longer time. Okay. So what does this indicate? Any answer? You can answer in the chat box.
Asthma.
Yeah, in a better way. In a better way.
Obstruction.
Yeah.
Asthma. Bronchospasm. One answered.
Okay, so the correct answer was bronchospasm, which is seen in asthma. So asthma is one of the condition where you get bronchospasm. In bronchiolitis also, you can get this kind of thing. Okay, so decreased peak expiratory flow and prolonged expiratory time. Right. Now, see the same. This was asthmatic patient. There was decreased peak expiratory flow and prolonged expiratory time. So we gave nebulization. So what happened? The peak expiratory flow increased and the expiratory time came down. Okay, fine. Now, another use of flow time scalar is, again, this is auto-PEEP. Okay, where again the peak expiratory flow came down. It is the expiration is happening over a longer time. And some air is getting trapped. The entire air is not getting emptied. Some air is getting trapped. So this is what we call auto-PEEP, right? So that also you can detect in flow time scalar. Now, pressure time scalar. What are the uses of pressure time scalar? So one is to identify the type of breath. I'm not talking about the mode, a type of breath. See? So if it is starting from the baseline like this, this is the mandatory breath. If there is a negative deflection at the starting, that means it is an assisted breath. Now, spontaneous breath will be a negative pressure. Inspiration will be negative pressure. And the flow waveform will be sinusoidal. You don't get sinusoidal waveform in any other conventional mode of ventilation. Okay, another pressure time scalar use will be, I told you, plateau pressure, peak inspiratory pressure, difference is trans airway pressure, right? So when there is in a patient like asthma, there will be high resistance. So again, remember the straw and balloon. So in an asthma patient, there is a high resistance here. So the trans airway pressure is very high. So in an asthmatic patient, the difference between plateau pressure and peak inspiratory pressure will be increasing. Now, if the plateau pressure itself is increasing, but the ear, the difference is the same. So that means that the lung pressure is very high. Or in the other way, you need to give high pressure to inflate the lungs. So that means the lung is having very poor compliance like ARDS or pneumonia, right? Now coming to volume time scalar. So the most important use of volume time scalar is to detect air leak. So as soon as you intubate any patient and connect to ventilator, first we will be looking at the volume time scalar, how the volume time, whether there is a leak or not, right? Okay. So we'll be discussing, so what is the air leak means that we have given 100 ml to the patient, but we are getting back only 80 ml. So we have lost 20 ml somewhere. So that 20 ml could be because of the ET cuff tube leak, because it was a smaller tube. It could be because there is a small disconnection between the ET tube and the ventilator. There is a small air leak there. It could be that some wires are not properly connected in the ventilator circuit. So all these things can contribute leak. So when you see a leak, you have to look from one end to the another end of the ventilator circuit where the leak is happening and correct it, right? Now coming to, so we have finished scalars. Now we have come to loops, right? So loops, it's pressure volume loop or flow volume loop. So coming to pressure volume loop. So here the pressure is in the x-axis and volume is in the y-axis, right? So you can see initially, when we increase the pressure, there is a small rise in the volume, and after it reaches a point, then for when we inflate or when we give pressure, there is a large increase, and after a point, whatever pressure you give, it won't increase. So that is why I'll just show you again, there is a straw balloon, right? Now, when you complete, imagine if the balloon is completely deflated and you start blowing air from here, initially you need to give excess pressure, right? And after the balloon inflates to an extent, from there you just blow slowly, the balloon will get inflated. So all of you have experienced that. So it is the same with lungs, okay? So initially you give pressure, you need more pressure to give to increase the volume, and after a point there will be, for a smaller pressure there will be higher increase in the volume. So that is why we set a peep. So this point is called lower inflection point, and that is why in ventilated patients, at least even in normal lung, we set a minimal peep of somewhere around 5 to keep the balloon inflated at this point, so that we can, from here we can ventilate very easily, right? Now PV loop, again it can be used to identify the mode, breath type. For example, this is a controlled breath. Now assisted breath will have a negative deflection. In spontaneous breath, PV loop, the inspiration will be in the negative side. Now the slope of the PV loop. Okay, so I'll give, so if the if the inspiratory part is getting bulged, that means increasing inspiratory resistance. But in asthma, there will be increased expiratory resistance, so the expiratory part will get bulged. Okay, and this slope of the PV loop gives you compliance. So that is the slope. So if the slope is like this, that means the lung was compliant, and after a point of time you see that the PV loop has flattened, so that is the slope has come down, that means the lung has become bad or the compliance has decreased, right? Now again, so I told you after a point of time how much pressure you give the lung, there is a capacity for the balloon, right? After you inflate, what will happen? The balloon will break. Okay, so there's a limit for the balloon to get inflated. So this is called peaking or over distension, or you are giving excess pressure. So this indicate peaking or over distension. Now again, in lowest volume always indicate leak, right? You gave 100 ml, you get back only 80 ml. That means 20 ml you are leaking somewhere. Now flow volume loop, this is exactly similar to what we use in our routine spirometry. Okay, so this upper part is the inspiratory part and lower part is the expiratory part. So using the upper part, you can detect the mode. So this is constant flow or a square waveform. So this means that this is patient is in volume control mode, and the lower part gives you information about peak expiratory flow. And this is the normal flow. If the peak expiratory flow decreases like this and it gets prolonged, then that indicates bronchospasm, right? So this is a volume control where you have a constant flow. This is pressure control where you have a decelerating flow. Now airway obstruction. So this was a normal patient, and after some time you find that the peak expiratory flow has come down and the expiratory part is getting scooping. So this indicate bronchospasm. See, normal patient, bronchospasm, and you give nebulization and you find that peak expiratory flow has increased and the scooping has disappeared. Again, a lowest volume always indicates air leak. And a flow volume loop, if the expiratory part is going this way, this indicates autopeak. So what is, this is a very, I would say this is a commonest finding you can see, not only in the flow volume, any graphics. So this indicate, these are called serrations. So this indicate there are secretions and you need to do suctioning. Okay, now this I already explained. So from volume time scalar, what all we can identify? Volume time scalar, so we can identify this is the tidal volume. You can identify autopeep. If the volume time scalar is going like this way, it is indicate active escalation. And leak, if the volume time scalar is not touching baseline, that indicates air leak. Again, pressure time scalar, you can identify the mode using the whether it is a square or ascending waveform. You can identify the type of breath by looking at the triggering when there is a negative inspiration. Then you can identify the peak in airway pressure, plateau pressure, mean airway, everything you can identify. Flow time scalar, again you can identify the flow time scalar is the scalar used to identify the mode. Then you can identify autopeep, airway obstruction, bronchodilator response, air leak, etc. using flow time scalar. So I have completed the theory part and now we will be going for the exercise. So be ready. So first exercise is identify the mode of the ventilation. You can answer in the chat box. I will give you enough time because I want all of you to learn. So excellent, I am getting good answers. So mode, I told you, you look at the flow waveform. So it is sinusoidal waveform. So it is spontaneous mode of ventilation. So or spontaneous breathing, it's spontaneous breathing. Now look, the inspiratory part will, spontaneous breathing is like a negative pressure breathing. So the inspiratory part will be negative. So just look at the flow, and if it is sinusoidal, it is spontaneous breathing. Excellent. Now identify the mode of the ventilation.
Pressure, one answered. Pressure mode. All answered pressure mode.
Very good, very good. So it is pressure control mode. So you look at the flow waveform, it is decelerating flow. That itself says it is a pressure mode. Oh, you can also see the pressure waveform, which is square. Okay, it's just constant pressure waveform. So this is pressure control mode. Identify the mode.
Volume unanswered, Jyothi Shankara. Danish volume.
Excellent. Okay, so this was easy. So I told you volume, flow is synonymous with volume. And so in, if the flow is square or the flow is constant flow, it indicates volume control mode, right? Very good. So identify the mode. Just I would give you a clue. Just look here. It is something different.
Answers are coming. Pressure control plus pressure supported. Pressure with auto PEEP. Pressure supported. PRVC.
Okay, so excel. Okay, so just look at the difference between this graph and this graph. Okay, so here the expiration was getting terminated while the flow was zero, right? Now see here, while the flow was some 25% of the baseline, it is getting terminated. So this is called flow cycling. So cycling is a parameter what terminates the inspiration. So this is time cycling and this is flow cycling. So flow cycling happens in pressure support mode, pressure support ventilation. Okay, so when you wean the patient, you put the patient on pressure support ventilation. So, but it's not just pressure support. Here we have set a PEEP also, that is CPAP. So it is pressure support ventilation plus CPAP. So this kind of flow cycling happens only in pressure support. Now, somebody answered pressure control plus pressure support, but see, all the breaths are of same type. So there is a single breath type, but where each are flow cycled. So flow cycling happens only in pressure support ventilation. And here we have set a CPAP also. It is PSV plus CPAP mode. Now identify this. The clue is there are two types of breath here. The question is to identify the mode only.
Pressure support, PSTVG, assisted breaths. Pressure control and pressure support ventilation. Not much answers are coming. They need more explanation.
Okay, fine. So see, there are two type of breath here. So to identify the mode, always look at the flow waveform. So this is simple, right? What we discussed, square flow waveform. That means constant flow or constant volume. So these are volume controlled breaths, right? But the patient is triggering, but they are volume controlled breaths. Volume control assisted breaths. Because there is a negative deflection, these are volume control assisted breath, right? Now see, this is also the same volume control assisted breath, but there are in between, there are flow cycle breaths also. Okay, so what does this mean? So we have put the patient on volume control SIMV plus pressure support. So in a SIMV, what does the SIMV means? For example, we said 20 rates, there will be controlled breaths, and so there will be some controlled breaths. And in SIMV, if the patient breathes more, so that breaths will be supported. So we can set a pressure support. So there are controlled breaths plus supported breaths. So it means that this is volume control SIMV plus pressure support, right? I think it's clear. Now identify this. Again, there are two types of breaths. That's a simple clue.
Volume control flow cycle, pressure control SIMV pressure support, SIMV pressure control plus pressure support.
So excellent. So just look at
B.
Yes, very good. So just look at the flow.
Pressure support.
Very good. I'm getting good answers. So just look at the flow. This is a decelerating flow. Decelerating flow means pressure control mode, right? So pressure control will be square wave. So you look at the flow. So this is pressure control board. But patient is, this is also assisted breath. Now see, there are different kind of flow cycle breath also. So this is just a pressure supported breath. Okay, so the patient is in pressure control SIMV plus pressure support plus we have given a in pressure mode, we have given a PEEP also. So it is pressure control SIMV plus pressure support, right? Very good. So now we go to few case scenarios. So a 5-year-old boy, non-case of asthma, he presented with acute exacerbation with severe respiratory distress. He didn't improve on conventional measures and we had to intubate him. So his various graphics are given below. So I want to identify the mode and other findings. So first is identify the mode. Then identify the breath type. Then what are the abnormalities you see in the patient? Okay, so I got answers. It is volume control mode because the flow is, this is a notation for flow. So it is constant flow. So the mode is volume control mode. Very good. Now the next step is identify the breath type. So by breath type, I mean it is a controlled or so controlled breath or mandatory, both are same. So we have got the answer because there is no negative deflection here. So it is a mandatory breath or a controlled breath. So had it been an assisted breath, we would have got a negative deflection here. So it is a mandatory breath or a controlled breath. Now, what are the abnormalities you see in these graphics? So either this arrow or circle notes the abnormalities. What you see in a asthmatic patient. So what are the abnormalities you see? So from here you start, what is abnormality in this arrow? So I think we have got all the answers. Excellent. So one is, yes, there is a decreased peak expiratory flow. Then this indicates auto PEEP, air is getting trapped. Okay, fine. Now this indicate there is an increased gradient between the peak inspiratory pressure and plateau pressure. That means increased trans airway pressure, right? So these are the abnormalities what we see. Okay, fine. Fantastic. Everybody have given the answer. So just you see this terminology of an auto PEEP and people are getting confused what it is. So what is auto PEEP? So that means a inadvertent PEEP or an unintentional PEEP that occurs with the patient receiving ventilatory support when a new expiratory breath is begun before the expiratory flow has ended. So there is some air trapping happening. Okay. So the causes could be there is increased expiratory resistance so that expiration should not get emptied, or the patient had bronchospasm, or there was very low expiratory time set by the doctor, right? So how to identify otopip? So in pressure time, what? On expiratory hold, the waveform rises above baseline. In the flow time, the expiratory flow doesn't return to the baseline. Volume time, the expiratory portion doesn't return to baseline. Okay, so all this way, in all scalars, we can detect otopip. Now, this is another case scenario, a 3-year-old boy, a case of ARDS, we were ventilating him in pressure control mode. So this is the ventilatory graphics on the day one, and day three, you find that the graphics is like this. Okay, or this is the PV loop on day one and day three. So what is the abnormality? Hello, Sabik. Have you got any answers?
One second.
Yeah. So most of them have answered. So there is an increase in the plateau pressure. So which indicates that, and see the slope of the PV loop. The PV loop slope was initially like this. Now it has flattened. So this indicates decreased compliance. So what will you do? What will be your so in a ARDS lung you have decreased compliance. So what will be your mode of correcting that? Any answers?
No. Increase pressure. Increase PAP. One answer, increase
P. Okay, so that is the correct answer. So to improve the lung compliance, you will have to increase the P, right? This is out of context, I just asked. Okay. Now, coming to the last case scenario. A 10-year-old child presented with a traumatic brain injury following a road traffic accident. He was intubated in emergency with a 4.5 size ET tube and shifted to PICU. And as soon as you connected the patient to the ventilator, you got these graphics. So what do you, it was a cuffed endotracheal tube. So what do you interpret and what will you do?
Air leak.
Excellent. So I told you, as soon as you intubate the patient, look at the volume time scalar. So volume time scalar is not touching the baseline. So, okay. So now what would be the first question? What would be the appropriate size of cuffed endotracheal tube for a 10-year-old child?
Use proper size ET tube answers 6.5. Dr. Pooja.
Cuffed. I am asking about the size of proper size of a cuffed endotracheal tube.
10-year-old.
Okay, so H by 4 plus 4 gives you the appropriate
so
size of an uncuffed endotracheal tube, and for cuffed it will be H by
6.5. Dr. Jumana 6. Swadi 5.5. They have to just calculate it there. Five point five. Okay. Your screen sharing is gone. Hello, sir. Hello. Dr. Rauf, can you hear me? We'll wait for a while. I think he's gone out. Okay, Dr. Rauf, you can start screen sharing. You are muted.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear. Please.
Just give me 1 minute, Anna.
Okay.
Is my screen visible now?
Yeah, not full screen.
Wait.
It's gone.
Wait.
Yeah, visible.
No, I'm unable to move the screen. Why?
You need to make full screen and then start screen sharing.
Okay.
You take to your current slide and then start screen sharing.
Okay, wait. Anyway, we'll give you a short break. I have finished the first session and was about to move to second session. Just Sabika, I'm facing some problem.
Okay. They can revise.
They can revise. 1 minute.
Just... Next session will be ABG analysis.
Yeah, we'll.
I please unmute yourself, Dr. Rauf.
Yeah.
Okay.
Am I audible okay. Now?
Yeah.
Yeah, just give me 1 minute to charge. Okay. You can, the students can take a break 1 minute. I'll be back. Okay, fine. So now we are moving to the second session. So do we have any doubts to be cleared in the first session? You can ask now. I think though accidentally we got a few minutes break.
It was a timely.
Yeah. So does anybody have any doubts?
we can start. I think no comments are there in
chat box. Fine. Okay, so now we are moving to ABG analysis. Again, I will be going very slow because I want to learn you all the concepts. So during your training time, you see a lot of ABGs in the PICUs, NICUs, and many a time you feel that it's very difficult. And like the concepts like anion gap, delta, delta gap, etc. But I tell you, if you understand the basic concepts, even to identify the most difficult ABG, it won't take more than 5 minutes. Okay, so by the end of this presentation, you should be able to do that. So we move on to the presentation. So first I will be dealing the theory part, and then we will have the exercise. So why do you do ABG? So what all information that? So you need to know the acid-base status, the status about oxygenation, the status about ventilation, and the modern day ABGs, they also gives you co-oximetry where you get information about the abnormal hemoglobins, right? So what is the importance of pH control? So why we need to have a pH of 7.4 or somewhere around 7.4? Because all our enzymes, body enzymes, work the best in that pH. Okay, for example, myocardium. So myocardium works best above pH of 7.4. So in patient with myocarditis, you tend to keep the pH at least above 7.3 because acidosis is very harmful for the myocardium and it will deteriorate the myocardial function. Same holds for all other cells. So the regulation of arterial pH by buffers, and the buffers, the main buffer in our body is bicarbonate based buffer. So it changed carbonic acid, which changed to water and carbon dioxide. That is how the buffering action happens. So the intracellular buffers are this is more of theory, bicarbonate, hemoglobin, phosphate, etc. And the extracellular buffers are bicarbonate, proteins, and phosphate. So the role of respiratory system is in the elimination of the volatile acid, that is the carbon dioxide. So when there is an acidosis, there will be a change in the pH of CSF, and that is detected by the respiratory center. And what happens? The respiratory center gets stimulated and increased ventilation happens, and the CO2 is washed out. Now, the role of kidney will be retaining the bicarbonate or excreting the acid, right? So the most proximal tubule, the 90% bicarbonate absorption happens at the proximal tubule. Okay, so that is why in proximal renal tubular acidosis, you get severe acidosis and you need to give very high dose of bicarbonate supplementation to compensate for that acidosis. So now what are the normal values? So the pH is, the normal value is 7.4, PCO2 40, the range is 35 to 45, bicarbonate 24, and PO2 80 to 100. So our main target is pH 7.4, PCO2 40, 24. So though there is a physiological range, for purpose of analysis, we need to remember a single value, right? So any pH below 7.4 will be acidosis, above 7.4 will be alkalosis. So same with CO2, less than 40, more than 40, bicarbonate, less than 40, less than 24 will be acidosis, more than 24 will be alkalosis, right? So for analytical purpose, you need to remember single values. So what are the pre-analytical errors that can happen? So air bubble. So if air bubble get mixed, there will be falsely elevated PaO2 and falsely elevated decreased PaCO2. Again, delayed analysis, there will be consumption of O2, which will lead to decreased PaO2 and increased PCO2. So ABG should be analyzed as soon as possible. So at least before 5 minutes, right? Otherwise, it should be kept with the ice bag. Now, venous blood admixture, again, obviously, it will show decreased PaO2 and increased PCO2. Now, what about anticoagulant effect? So we always use heparin as the anticoagulant. So the most advisable is the pre-heparinized syringes. So if it is not available, dilution of heparin advisable is 1:1000 heparin. So you know that heparin comes in different dilution. So 1:1000 heparin, you have to take that in the syringe and you have to flush out. so that there is no visible heparin left in the syringe, and then take the sample. If heparin get admixed, what will happen? There can be decreased bicarbonate and decreased PaCO2, and there won't be any change in the pH. This can be a OSCE question, right? Now, how to check for the consistency of the ABG, whether the ABG machine is accurate or not. So this again is more of theoretical. Mostly this doesn't happen, or the machine is calibrated or not. So this is given by the Endesen-Hasselbalch equation. So H plus into HCO3 by PaCO2 should be equal to 24. So how you calculate the H plus? So you subtract the last two digits of the pH from 80. So just imagine normal pH is 7.40. So subtract 40 from 80. So the normal H plus is 40, right? So 40 into normal bicarbonate is 24, and normal PCO2 is 40. So this byproduct should be 24. If it is 24, that means that this is calibrated properly. Again, I tell you, this is theoretical aspect. Most of the time, we don't do this. Now, what are the steps for successful blood gas analysis? Now, consider the clinical setting. First step, so you have to anticipate the disorder. It is not that you just blindly look at the ABG and interpret it. You have to know what is the patient, what kind of patient this is, what is the history. Then only the appropriate interpretation of ABG is possible. This is very important. Now, next step is, what is the pH? So in what direction the pH has gone, whether it is acidotic range or alkalotic range. Next would be, if there is an acidosis or if there is an alkalosis, who is the primary culprit, whether it is bicarbonate or whether it is the CO2. Now, if you identify that if it is metabolic acidosis or metabolic alkalosis, then you look for respiratory compensation. And in metabolic acidosis, you have to look the anion gap. Okay. Now, if you find the culprit is CO2, that is, it is a respiratory acidosis or respiratory alkalosis, then you have to look at the, you have to look for metabolic compensation, right? Then you have to look whether there is a mixed disorder or not. And then for the completion sake, you have to look at the oxygenation also. So first you look at the pH. So anything below 7.4, it is acidosis. Anything above 7.4, it will be alkalosis, right? If the pH is 7.4 also, it can be normal, or there can be a mixed disorder, or it could be a compensated. But most of the time we say compensation is never perfect. So compensation will never be able to bring down the pH to the exact normal value. So you find there is a acidosis, and then you look for the culprit. If the CO2 is more than 40, it is respiratory acidosis. Or if the bicarbonate is less than 24, it is metabolic acidosis, and vice versa, right? So what is respiratory acidosis? These all are the basics I know, but just refreshing it. So that means that there is a primary alteration in ventilation, and that is responsible for the change in CO2, which is responsible for the change in pH and the acidosis or the alkalosis, right? Now, metabolic means the primary culprit is something to do with the H plus or the bicarbonate. So the compensation will be, so our body will be, the homeostasis will try to maintain the pH closer to 7.4. So it would be extremely unusual for the respiratory or renal system to overcompensate. So there, overcompensation never happens. So if you see overcompensation, it means that there is a mixed disorder, right? So if the primary culprit is in bicarbonate, the body will try to compensate by respiratory mechanism, which will be faster. So if there is a metabolic acidosis, the lungs will start ventilating faster. The brain will give signal. There will be faster respiratory rate, and compensation will be faster. Now, if there is a primary respiratory disorder, again, the renal compensation will happen, but that there will be initial buffering, which happens faster, but the complete renal compensation is going to take at least 48 to 72 hours. So then simple disorder means there is a single acid-base disorder. A mixed disorder means there are more than one acid-base disorder, right? So again, in metabolic acidosis, there is a increase in H+, which has gone led to decreased pH. There is primary culprit is decreased bicarbonate. So the compensation will be there will be hyperventilation and body will try to decrease the CO2. So the compensation happens in the same direction, decreased bicarbonate, decreased CO2, right? So in metabolic alkalosis, there is decreased H plus, increased pH, increased bicarbonate. So the compensation will be in the same direction. There will be, body will try to increase the CO2 by hypoventilating. Same way, respiratory acidosis, there is increased PCO2 due to some reason. So body will try to increase the bicarbonate. The kidney will try to accumulate the bicarbonate and try to increase the pH. And same vice versa for the respiratory alkalosis. Just remember, compensation happens in the same direction. Now, what are the alerts to mixed acid-base disorders? So if there is no compensation at all, or if there is overcompensation, so both indicates mixed disorder. Or if there is a long-standing pulmonary or renal disease, or if the patient is on controlled ventilation. For just imagine, if the patient is having metabolic acidosis, so the brain will give signal to breathe more. But imagine if the patient is ventilated on paralyzed, the patient cannot breathe more, right? So that will lead to mixed acid-base disturbance. Body cannot compensate at all. So what are the settings of mixed acid-base disorders? So these are some examples. You can take a screenshot of this. You don't need to by heart this. For example, metabolic acidosis plus respiratory acidosis. Imagine cardiopulmonary arrest. So what happens? There will be, because of arrest, there will be poor perfusion and lactic acidosis leading to metabolic acidosis. Same time, the patient is not ventilating properly, there will be a respiratory acidosis also. Now, metabolic acidosis plus respiratory alkalosis. The classical example is salicylate intoxication, which causes a high energy of metabolic acidosis, and also salicylate per se stimulate the respiratory center that will cause CO2 washout, causing respiratory alkalosis. Now, metabolic acidosis plus metabolic alkalosis example will be renal failure with vomiting. Then this is a classical example for metabolic alkalosis plus respiratory acidosis, cystic fibrosis. You know, in cystic fibrosis, there will be a chronic CO2 retention, bronchiectasis, etc., which lead to respiratory acidosis. And cystic fibrosis per se, through the skin, there will be loss of H plus and chloride, which lead to metabolic alkalosis. So now we move to metabolic acidosis. So metabolic acidosis simply means that there is a disorder in the bicarbonate. So this can be by two ways. So one way is there is some extra acids which have accumulated in the body led to metabolic acidosis. Second could be body has lost bicarbonate by any mechanism. Okay, so this mechanism could be through kidney or could be through GIT. For example, diarrhea causing bicarbonate loss that can lead to metabolic acidosis. Kidney, classical example is renal tubular acidosis. So this type will be normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. And if there are extra acid coming to the body, for example, shock leading to lactic acidosis, DKA due to keto acids, IEMs due to any other organic acids. So all these conditions, there are extra acids. So this will be high anion gap metabolic acidosis, and in conditions where we are losing bicarbonate ourselves, so that will be normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. So the compensation will be by what happens in metabolic acidosis. We try to increase respiratory rate, that is what we call acidotic breathing or Kussmaul respiration. Body will try to decrease the CO2 to maintain the pH, right? So how to calculate compensation in the metabolic? So compensation here, I'm going to stress that this is a difficult part. Okay. So just remember, in metabolic acidosis, there are different ways of assessing the compensation. So here I have taken an example. The pH is 7.22. Bicarbonate is 10. Okay. So CO2 is 24. So you look at the pH. So it is in the acidotic range. So you identify that there is a acidosis, right? Now you look at the bicarbonate and CO2, which has moved in the direction of acidosis. You find that bicarbonate has decreased. So bicarbonate is in the direction of acidosis. Look at CO2, it is 24. It is in the direction of alkalosis. So the primary culprit for pH is metabolic acidosis. So you identify that there is metabolic acidosis. So I told you next step will be to look at compensation. So how to look at the compensation? So in metabolic acidosis, there are different ways. So first is to look at the last two digits of pH. So 22. So 22 will be the anticipated CO2 and the compensation being complete. Okay. So here the CO2 is 24. So that indicates it is inadequately compensated. So this is simplest way of looking at it. Now another way is, I would teach you this way, 1.2 into change in bicarbonate. So here the change in bicarbonate is 14, right? It has decreased from 24 to 10. So it will be 24 into 1.2, right? That will be the CO2 reduction. This should be the CO2 reduction. So, got it wrong. So here change is 14, right? From 24, it has come down to 10. So the change in bicarbonate is 14. So 1.2 into 14 will be the CO2 reduction. So this will be roughly somewhere 18. So again, so the change in CO2 will be 18 means that the CO2 has to come down from 40 by 18. So 40 minus 18 will be again 22, right? Now you have another formula, Windes formula, which gives you the expected CO2. So this formula only you need to remember. So it is 1.5 into bicarbonate plus 8 plus minus 2. Again, 1.5 into bicarbonate will be 15. So 15 plus 8 will be 23. So 23 plus minus 2 will be the expected PCO2. So remember, there are three ways. One is look at the last two digit. That will be the expected CO2. Other will be, I would urge you to remember this, 1.2 into change in bicarbonate. So that will give you the expected change in CO2. Or you can remember by Windes formula. I will summarize in the end. Don't get confused. So now I'm coming to anion gap. So anion gap, often it is getting, people get confused. So the simplest way is, just remember that it is a quantification of the unmeasured anions. Or just remember that it indicates whether there are extra acids or not. That is the simplest way to remember. Okay. So just see, this is a normal plasma. There is sodium, there is unmeasured cation, there is chloride, bicarbonate. These are the measured anion, and then there is the unmeasured anion. So this unmeasured anion minus unmeasured cation gives you the normal anion gap, which you remember as single value will be 12. Okay. So that is sodium minus chloride minus bicarbonate. So this is the normal, so difference between sodium minus chloride minus bicarbonate. So this gives you the anion gap, right? Now in high anion gap metabolic acidosis, what happens is some extra acids are added, like be it keto acid, lactic acid, organic acid, some extra acids are added. So when extra acids are added, what will happen? They will buffer the bicarbonate. And okay, so here the anion gap increases. So that means increased anion gap about 12 means that there are some extra acids in the body. Now, in normal anion gap, what is happening? This is the normal bicarbonate pool. We are losing some bicarbonate. Okay, it may be either through the GIT or through the kidney. So the chloride has expanded. So this is called a hyperchloremic acidosis or normal anion gap acidosis. There is no change in the anion gap. It means that the chloride has increased and we have lost bicarbonate. So this is normal anion gap. The acidosis is not because of extra acids. It is because we have lost bicarbonate. I hope I have made it clear. So what are the examples for increased anion gap? So you remember it as Kusmol, keto acids. It could be starvation ketoacids or diabetic ketoacids, uremia, starvation, salicyclic poisoning, methanol poisoning, alcohol, lactic acidosis, etc. Now you remember normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, dura, that is diarrhea. Then this is renal tubular acidosis, ammonium chloride poisoning. This is uretrosigmoidostomy. Okay, fine. Now we come to respiratory acidosis. So respiratory acidosis means the patient, we have accumulated the CO2, right? So this can be acute or chronic. For example, classical example for the acute could be pneumothorax. Patient on ventilator suddenly developed pneumothorax. What will happen? The ventilation won't happen. The patient will accumulate CO2. That is an acute respiratory acidosis. Now, the patient with neuromuscular disorder who is hypoventilating chronically, a neuromuscular, for example, any myopathy, they ventilate very slowly. So they develop chronic respiratory acidosis. Okay. So the compensation here, there will be rapid buffering happening, but the complete compensation by kidney takes time. So now we move to metabolic alkalosis. So there are two ways. One is chloride responsive and chloride resistant. So just remember, chloride responsive means that it is loss of H+. So it means by vomiting, classical contraction alkalosis, what we see in hypertrophic pyloric stenosis is a classical example of chloride responsive. And the chloride resistant means that we have gained some bicarbonate by some other mechanism. The classical example would be Bartter syndrome. Okay. That is chloride responsive and chloride resistant metabolic alkalosis. Now, how to look for the compensation? So there are different formulas. I will teach you a simple formula is, so the change in PCO2 in metabolic acidosis was 1.2 into change in bicarbonate. So just remember the half of that. Change in CO2 in metabolic alkalosis is 0.6 into change in delta bicarbonate. The change in CO2 will be 0.6 into change in bicarbonate. We will see by different example. Okay. Now in respiratory alkalosis, for example, the classical example would be a patient with a CNS disorder where it will be a neurogenic hyperventilation. So that will lead to respiratory alkalosis. So I will just summarize in this single slide, which will you just remember this slide and practice on this slide. The compensation will be very easy for you. So just remember this. In metabolic acidosis, the change in CO2 will be 1.2 times the change in bicarbonate. In metabolic alkalosis, 0.6 CO2 change per bicarbonate. Now, I told you in respiratory acidosis, there will be some acute compensation and complete compensation will take time, acute and chronic. So just remember this 1, 2, 3, 4. That is, in acute respiratory acidosis, there will be change of one bicarbonate. This is change per 10 CO2. Here changes, this is per one bicarbonate. So in respiratory acidosis, for example, from the CO2 goes from 40 to 50. So per 10 bicarbonate, there will be one increase in the bicarbonate for 10 CO2. If it is a chronic respiratory acidosis, there will be for 10 CO2 change, there will be increase by 3, right? Now in respiratory alkalosis, for acute, there will be 2 change in bicarbonate per 10 CO2. For example, from CO2 has gone from 40 to 30. For this 10, the bicarbonate will decrease by 2. If it is a chronic respiratory alkalosis, again, the bicarbonate for this 10 change will decrease by 4. So just remember, so the compensation I'm making, trying to make it easy. Just remember 1.2, 0.6, 1, 2, 3, 4. So whenever you get a, whenever I get a ABG, so I just remember this four, these values and just calculate the compensation. So 1.2, 0.6, 1, 2, 3, 4. Just remember this and this will help you in the coming exercises. Now, assessment of gas exchange, there are different ways. This is again a little out of context. So A- AO2, this can give you an idea of gas exchange. This is alveolar oxygen minus arterial oxygen. This should be less than 10. Some books say less than 6. If it is more than 10, it indicates impaired gas exchange. Now, the other would be arterial oxygen level itself. We learned that the range is between 80 to 100. So anything less than 80 will be hypoxemia. Now for a ventilated patient, better will be PaO2 by FiO2 ratio. So by the Berlin criteria, if this is less than 300, that it indicates mild ARDS. Now the latest will be oxygenation index, which will be mean airway pressure MAP divided by PF ratio. So oxygenation index more than 4 indicate mild ARDS according to the latest PADS definition. Okay, so just refreshing the steps. First, look at the pH. Then look who is the culprit. Then look for the compensation. Then if there is a metabolic disorder, then look for the anion gap. Now, if there is respiratory, then look for the other compensation. Now, you can look at the oxygenation status also for the complete analysis. Now, there is something called delta anion gap and delta-delta anion that I will come to later. So here we start the assessment. So this is the simplest example. So you can start giving your answers in the chat box. So you can keep a pen and paper with you, calculate and take your own time. Samik, any answers?
No, 1 second. No answers yet.
So I tell you, first look at the pH that give you acidosis or alkalosis. Then look
compensated
at
metabolic acidosis. Compensated metabolic acidosis. Compensated metabolic acidosis. Metabolic acidosis, the respiratory compensation. Compensated metabolic acid. That's all the answers.
Okay. So I told you, first look at the pH. So it is acidotic, right? Now look at CO2 and bicarbonate. So bicarbonate is in there. It is less than 24. That means there is no doubt that it is a metabolic acidosis. So I told you metabolic acidosis, what is the simplest way to look at the compensation? You can, there are different way. You look at this 34. So had it been completely compensated, CO2 would have come down to 34. Or in the other way, the pH is not completely normal, right? So if it is complete compensation, the pH should normalize. So I would call this as the pH is not normal, since it is partially compensated metabolic acidosis. That is the complete answer. It's not completely compensated, partially compensated metabolic acidosis with normal oxygenation, right? For complete compensation, the pH should normalize. So this is the second example. You take your pen, paper, look at the pH, look at the CO2 and bicarbonate, who is the primary culprit, then calculate the compensation. So when you mention compensated, you should mention whether it is partially compensated or completely compensated. Okay. So if it is complete compensation, the pH should normalize. I'm waiting for answers. Okay. So I'm getting good answers. So this is partially, look at the pH alkalotic range. Look at CO2 and bicarbonate. Who is in the range of alkalosis? Bicarbonate, right? So there is no doubt it is metabolic alkalosis. Everybody can diagnose that. Now look at the CO2. It is 49. Okay. So I told you 24. There is, what is the change in bicarbonate? 24, right? So in metabolic alkalosis, so 1.2, 0.6, 1234. You just write this. So metabolic alkalosis, 0.6 into change in bicarbonates, 24 into 0.6 will be somewhere around 13, 14, right? So for the complete compensation, CO2 change should be 14. It means from 40, the CO2 should go to 54 for the complete compensation. Then only the pH will normalize, but the CO2 has reached 49 only. So it is partially compensated, right? If anybody have doubt, I'm ready to clear. No problem. We go to the next example. I give you the, this is a, I have to give you the scenario here. It, just remember, it is an acute scenario. It is a patient with acute pneumothorax.
Answers are there. Acute respiratory acidosis with partial compensation. Respiratory acidosis.
Just look at the bicarbonate again. Look at the bicarbonate value again.
And out came.
I saw that I will clear in the end.
Respiratory acidosis with acute partial compensation. Acute respiratory acidosis with partial compensation, fully compensated. Respiratory acidosis with metabolic acidosis, partially compensated respiratory acidosis.
Okay, so please, dear students, please listen. So, pH acidotic range, right? There is no doubt about that. There is acidosis. Our next step will be to look at the PCO2 and bicarbonate. So, what you are finding? The CO2 is above 40. It's in the acidotic range. So, you come to conclusion that there is respiratory acidosis. Now, see what has happened to bicarbonate. It is also in the acidotic range. So, from bicarbonate, for 24 in a respiratory acidosis, and the body was trying to compensate, what would have happened? The bicarbonate would have increased, right? I told you compensation happens in the same direction. But what has happened? Bicarbonate has come down instead of that. So that means that there is a metabolic acidosis also. So this is a simple mixed disorder where you have, for example, a respiratory patient developed pneumothorax, patient went to shock. What will happen? You can't just get off ABG. So there is a respiratory acidosis. Plus, there is a metabolic acidosis, right? So, if there was some compensation, the bicarbonate should have increased, but instead of that, it come down. So, there is some other cause for metabolic acidosis. So, this is a simple mixed disorder where you have both respiratory and metabolic acidosis. And there was hypoxemia also. Okay, right? No, please give answer. You take your own time. I want all of you to learn. I can wait for as much time you.
Metabolic acidosis.
So I give you a scenario. This is a chronic patient.
Metabolic acidosis. Respiratory acidosis with partial compensation. Respiratory acidosis with metabolic alkalosis compensation.
So I need to give the scenario here. So this is a patient with a cystic fibrosis. This is a chronic patient. Okay, this is a chronic patient. So whenever there is a respiratory disorder, you should ask me, sir, what is the case scenario, whether it is a acute or chronic. Then only you can interpret it properly. So this is a chronic cystic fibrosis patient. So when you see respiratory, you should be writing 1, 2, 3, 4. Sorry, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so, I got many answers, so I try to. So there is acidosis, right? There is no doubt about that. Look at the CO2. There is respiratory acidosis. Absolutely no doubt about that. Now bicarbonate is in the alkalotic range, so body has tried to compensate. So now you should find whether the compensation is appropriate or not. So I told you that this is a chronic scenario. So the bicarbonate carbon dioxide has gone from 40 to 80, right? 40 change. Or in the other way, 4 into 10 change. So in a chronic respiratory acidosis, we learned that 1, 2, 3, 4, that is 3 bicarbonate change for 10 CO2. So for 4 bicarbonate, what would have been the change? So it will be 3 × 4. So we would have got 12 change. Or for appropriate compensation, the bicarbonate would have gone to from 24 plus 12 would be 36. But our bicarbonate has reached 34.1. So the answer is there is chronic respiratory acidosis with partial compensation. So Dr. Sodhi has given the exactly the correct answer. So it is chronic respiratory acidosis with partial compensation. Perfect. With severe hypoxemia. Okay, fine. Now, here I go for the next concept, delta anion gap and delta gap-gap ratio, what you call. Okay. So this is a commonly confused topic. I'll try to keep it as simple as possible. Just listen. So in a patient with high anion gap, that is what we call HAGMA, there can be hidden normal anion gap. This is what typically happens in a patient with diabetic ketoacidosis. The initially, because of the keto acids, there will be high anion gap, for example, 30. So once you start treating this patient with IV fluid containing chloride, so there will be excess chloride, and after some point of time, this patient also develop normal and some hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Okay, so on day two, you find that the patient start improving, but the acidosis is still persisting, but the anion gap is coming down. So behind that, in patient with HAGMA, there can be a hidden normal anion gap. So how to find that? For that, this concept came, this delta ratio. So whenever there is extra three acids, there will be the bicarbonate. That means whenever there is an increase in anion gap by 3, this is an example I'm citing, there will be 3 bicarbonate buffered. That means bicarbonate will decrease by 3. So the normal ratio will be 1, right? Now, if this there is something abnormal in this ratio, that indicates that there is some other hidden metabolic pathway operating with this. So that is the way, by using this, we can identify different disorders. So I will give you an example. For example, in a patient where there are extra 3 acids, and you identify that by 3 acids, how you can identify? That means delta anion gap. So normal anion gap is 12. You find the anion gap is 15. So that means there are 3 extra acids, and you find that the bicarbonate has come down from delta bicarbonate. That is the change in bicarbonate from 24. Bicarbonate is 21. So that is perfect. That is normal. So the patient is having pure HAGMA, right? Pure high anion gap acidosis. Now you find that the delta ratio is less than 1. That means for 3 extra acids, bicarbonate is decreased by, example, by 5. So that means that apart from these 3 acids, the body, these 3 acids buffered 3 bicarbonate, but we also lost 2 bicarbonate also. So that means apart from the 3 bicarbonates buffered, we have lost 2 extra bicarbonate. So losing bicarbonate is NAGMA, that is normal anion gap. So if delta ratio is less than 1, it means that there is high anion gap plus normal anion gap acidosis, right? Now 1 to 2 range of delta ratio would indicate a pure high anion gap acidosis. So in lactic acidosis, we get a value of around 1.6, right? Now, if the value is more than 2, what does that mean? So it means we have 3 extra acids, but we find that we have lost only 1 bicarbonate. For example, the delta ratio is 3. We have lost only 1 bicarbonate. So what does that mean? So this means that we should have lost 3 bicarbonate, right? But instead of that, we have lost only 1. So that means in our body, somebody gave us 2 extra bicarbonate. That means there is excess 2 bicarbonate which has come from some other source. So that means there is a extra hidden metabolic alkalosis, right? So this means that there is a HAGMA plus there is a metabolic alkalosis. Now you just remember one more thing. So less than 1 means there is a hidden NAGMA. More than 2 means there is a hidden metabolic alkalosis. So only this mixed disorder can happen in high anion gap metabolic acidosis, not in a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. I think I have made it clear. Now you can we will further explain it by examples. So this is a case scenario. Sabik, you can read out that.
Okay, 1 second. Diksha has had vomiting and diarrhea for 3 days. In her mom's words, she can't keep anything down and she's running out. She had one wet diaper in the last 24 hours. She appears lethargic and cold to touch with a prolonged capillary refill time. After addressing her ABCs, her blood gas reveals pH 7.2, PCO2 26, bicarb 12.
Okay, so please interpret. Sabik, one Galaxy M30 has commented that they didn't understand. So please ask what concept. I think I will explain it again. So that person with Galaxy M30 can please tell what concept didn't you understand. So I will try to explain it again.
7 was asking whether partially compensated or uncompensated. I was telling
you can use any terms. So the traditional terminology is partially compensated or fully compensated. That is a traditional way of interpreting ABG. I think, and most of the physicians or most of the practitioners use that way only.
Then that guy has asked regarding delta anion gap.
Okay. I will explain. So after completing this example, we will go back and explain that.
We can give 1 minute time.
Yeah, sure. I don't mind. Okay, fine. I think the people are giving the answer. Okay, partially compensated metabolic acidosis, right? So look at the pH acidosis. Look at this. So this has gone in the acidotic range. So it is metabolic acidosis. Now you look at the simplest way would be the expected CO2 will be 20, but the CO2 is only 26. So body has tried to compensate from 40 to 26, but it has not reached 20 till now. So the answer would be partially compensated metabolic acidosis, right? Or I told you, or in the other way, you can calculate 1.2 into change in bicarbonate will be 1.2 into 12, roughly somewhere around 14. Will somewhere 1.2 into 12 will be some, there is 14, 15 something. Acid base status, respiratory. So metabolic acidosis with partial compensation. Okay, so now I'll just try to explain the delta anion gap again, because somebody, So please listen here. So delta anion gap is used to, in cases of HAGMA, high anion gap, metabolic acidosis, there can be hidden normal anion gap metabolic acidosis or hidden metabolic alkalosis. So how to identify that? For that, we use delta anion gap. So delta or delta ratio. So it is delta anion gap by delta bicarbonate. So I told you anion gap is the simplest way of understanding is extra acids. So if our body gets 3 extra acids, that 3 acids will buffer 3 bicarbonate, means 3 increase in extra acid will decrease your bicarbonate by 3, and the normal ratio will be 1, or you can remember between 1 to 2. As simple as that, right? Now, if you find that this ratio is less than 1, so what does this mean? So we add 3 extra acids, but there was 4 bicarbonate. Example I'm citing, there was 4 bicarbonate. So that means that 4 change in bicarbonate. So 3 acids buffered 3 bicarbonate, but we lost 1 more bicarbonate. So that losing bicarbonate is normal anion gap metabolic acid, either by kidney or diarrhea. So it means delta means there is a hidden NAGMA also, delta ratio less than 1. Now, if the delta ratio is more than 2, it means that our body had 3 extra acids, but we lost only 1 bicarbonate. So we should have lost 3 bicarbonate, right? So that we lost only 1 means somebody gave us 2 bicarbonate extra, or somebody added 2 extra bicarbonate to the pool. That means there is an hidden metabolic alkalosis, right? So I think I've explained it again. I think most of you would have understood by now. So we move to the second example. Sabik, please read out. Sabik, are you there? So I will read out. This is a 6-month-old boy, recurrent pneumonia, recurrent loose stool. Now he presented with fever, cough, rapid breathing. So he was given oxygen, antibiotics, bronchodilator therapy. He started showing improvement. So we did his ABG on day 5 and we got this ABG. So recurrent pneumonia, so it is a chronic disorder. Now interpret. Okay, we are getting many answers. So we'll see. So this, there is acidosis, right? And what has moved, CO2 is in the direction of acidosis. So there is no doubt there is respiratory acidosis. And this recurrent pneumonia, loose stool. Okay, so this is probably cystic fibrosis patient, right? You get this kind of thing. Okay, now you look at bicarbonate, it is 40. Okay, so remember again our 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so this is a chronic respiratory acidosis. Our CO2 has gone from 40 to 70. That is 3 into 10 change, right? So for a full compensation, what we expect, 3 into 3, that is 9 change in bicarbonate, right? So for a fully compensated, bicarbonate would have gone from 24 plus 9, which will be 33. But instead of that, what has happened? Bicarbonate is 40. So what does that mean? So I told you, overcompensation never happens. So from 33, instead of 33, bicarbonate is 40. So that means that it's a mixed disorder of respiratory acidosis and metabolic alkalosis. Now I'm getting some comments regarding the last example. Sir, actually there was some calculation mistake here. These figures, it was given roughly. I think the there is some calculation mistake given here, but because if you calculate the other way, you are getting it as compensated metabolic acidosis also. So these figures are not correct actually. There is something, some mistake has happened in the figures given, right? Now some people are raising one value, one point that I will try to clarify in the end. Okay. So I think this example, all of you have understood. So see, so instead of 33, it has gone to 40. So there is a metabolic alkalosis also present. So it is a respiratory acidosis with metabolic alkalosis. This is a classical ABG you get in a cystic fibrosis patient. Now look at this. A DKA patient was managed with insulin and therapy. he had altered sensorium initially, but by that too the sensorium improved, but we find that acidosis was persisting. So I have given the VBG below. So what you interpret from this? Yes, it is a venous bed gas. So we want to look at the metabolic status only. You are happy with it. So in decay and all, you can do VBG. We don't want to look at the oxygenation status. If you want to look at the metabolic status alone, a VBG is good enough. There will be a slight change in the pH compared to between VBG and ABG, but that doesn't matter. In decay, VBG is good enough. Now just interpret this. Okay, I'm getting good answers. So there is acidosis, no doubt. Look at bicarbonate. So it is a, there is no doubt of that. There is a metabolic acidosis. Okay, right. Now you look at the anion gap. That is sodium minus chloride plus bicarbonate. But the anion gap will be 13. So anything about 12, there is a HAGMA, no doubt about that. Now in HAGMA, I told you, you have to look at delta anion gap, right? So look at the delta anion gap. Delta anion gap is 1, delta bicarbonate is 14. So 1 by 14, so it is less than 1. So there is a hidden NAGMA also. So it is HAGMA plus NAGMA. Why the NAGMA has happened? Because you have given a lot of chloride containing fluid. Now there is another simple way of calculating hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, that is chloride by sodium ratio. So in normal body, chloride by sodium ratio will be 0.79. Okay. So this is how, for example, you know that the normal body sodium is physiological value will be 140 and chloride value will be like 100, around 100 to 105, right? So the normal ratio should be 0.79. So if the chloride increase above this ratio, what will happen? This excess chloride can bind with H plus and cause acidosis. So if you can look the ratio 117 by 140, I think this will be more than 0.8. So this is also causing some acidosis. So you look at the delta ratio, or this is another simple way of looking the chloride by sodium ratio to detect hyperchloremia. So hyperchloremia is not defined by a chloride value. It is depend by the chloride by sodium ratio, right? So there is acidosis, metabolic acidosis. Obviously the compensation is partial. Anion gap is 13, there is HAGMA, delta ratio less than 1, so it is HAGMA plus NAGMA. Sabik, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, please read out, please read out.
Actually, I'm going for seeing a case. Can you manage for 10
minutes? Sure. Yeah, so one child, he presented to emergency with history of fever for 7 days, tiredness, he had large hepatosplenomegaly, lymphadenopathy, was tachypneic. SpO2 was 99%. There was anemia. TLC was, there was hyperleukocytosis with blast, and there was thrombocytopenia. Probably the patient was having leukemia, right? And you do a ABG, and your junior brings back the report after some time, and you see that it was proper ABG only, but the PO2 was 50. You look at the pulse oximetry again and you find that saturation is 99%. So the question is, why is there a hypoxemia and what is this phenomenon called? No, this was a proper ABG. It was not a VBG. Look at this again, the elevated TLC. Any guesses? No. So, yeah, exactly. It's pseudo hypoxemia. Why there is a pseudo hypoxemia? Excellent. So Dr. Siddharth has said oxygen consumption. So this phenomenon is called leukocyte larceny. So what happens is, when you have such high number of leukocytes, when the blood is transported, these leukocytes consume the oxygen due to mitochondrial respiration inside the blood, and that lead to reduction in PaO2 by the time of analysis. So this is called a leukocyte larceny, which you see in when you have hyperleukocytosis. You can be prevented by immediate processing or by adding cyanide to the sampling. Okay, now just one more question, theoretical. The child is tachypneic. So why is the child tachypneic? The hypoxemia is pseudo, it is not correct. Then why is the child like tachypneic? A leukemic patient with hyperleukocytosis, why is the child tachypneic? This is nothing related to the ABG. Yeah, it's not exactly thromboembolism. It is because of the leukostasis, right? So the leukostasis can happen in pulmonary vessels, also in the CNS vessels. So when it happens in the pulmonary vessels, you get tachypnea. When it happens in the CNS vessels, you get alteration in the sensorium, right? Now, another example. A child with myopathy presented with respiratory infection and respiratory failure. You intubated the patient in emergency and ventilated him, and you did a ABG after 20 minutes. So this was showing alkalosis, probably metabolic alkalosis. Okay. So now the question is, what is the terminology used for this scenario, or why this alkalosis happened? So you expect a myopathy patient to be in acidosis, right? So why has this happened? Or what's the terminology used for this scenario? Anybody? So I will just explain you. So this is a patient with congenital myopathy, right? So his baseline CO2 would have been somewhere like 60 or 70. So his baseline bicarbonate body would have compensated and kept somewhere 35, 40, etc. Okay. Now what happened? You intubated this patient and did AmbuBac. So you washed out the CO2 immediately, right? So the CO2 got normalized. But what will happen to the bicarbonate? The bicarbonate will slowly normalize, right? Because the kidney will take time, it will lag behind. So this is called post-hypercapnic metabolic alkalosis, which is seen when you suddenly correct the CO2 in a patient with chronic CO2 retention. So this is a 45-day-old baby presenting with history of recurrent vomiting from 3 weeks of life. So the classical scenario of a hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, and you get this ABG. The pH is 7.57, PCO2 is 69, and bicarbonate is 62. So now please give your interpretation. It is a chronic disease. Another clue, this patient was having severe failure to thrive, and patient was in altered sensorium also. Any answers? Anybody? Okay, fine. I'm getting different answers. So you look at the pH. pH is 7.57. So it is in the alkalotic range, right? Look at bicarbonate and CO2. So the bicarbonate is in the alkalotic. So there is no doubt that there is a metabolic alkalosis. Absolutely, there should not be any doubt on this. Now you look at CO2. So for CO2 has tried assuming metabolic calculus, CO2 should increase. So CO2 has increased. So there is a body has tried to compensate. What has happened? CO2 has gone to 69, right? So what would have been the expected compensation in respect metabolic calculus? So you calculate 0.6 into change in bicarbonate, right? From 24, the bicarbonate has gone to 62. That means 38. So somewhere 38 into 0.6. So 0.6 into 38 will be somewhere something like 15, 16, something like that, right? Or 18, something like that. So the CO2 would have gone from 40 plus 18, somewhere like 60, etc. But the CO2 has gone to 69. So there is that way also you can interpret that there is a respiratory acidosis. Now, another way of doing this is there is something called compensation limits. That is, even for rest compensation, there is some limits. Like for CO2, compensation alone cannot take CO2 above 60 and below 10. So if there is a CO2 above 60 in a metabolic disorder, that means that it is not because of compensation, but because of a primary respiratory acidosis. Same way, if there is a, in a DKA patient, you see that CO2 is less than 10, you have to understand that that is not just because of compensation, there is a primary respiratory alkalosis. Same way, for a metabolic, the limit is 40 bicarbonate. If the bicarbonate goes above 40, that cannot be because of compensation alone. There is a primary metabolic pathology. There is a primary metabolic alkalosis. So this example was to teach you compensation limits. Now, this is the last example. So I'll take this example and there are some doubts which have appeared that then I will clear that. So please answer this example. Yeah, Dr. Saudi had given the complete answer for that last example. Excellent. So I will repeat the compensation limit again. After this example, I will repeat that. So, child with Bartter syndrome, this is the ABG. Yeah, I'm very happy to see excellent answers. So this is slightly tougher one, don't worry. There is acidosis. Okay. There is CO2 is increased, bicarbonate has come down. So there is, it should be a mixed respiratory and metabolic acidosis, right? Now somebody has calculated the anion gap. So the anion gap is chloride plus bicarbonate will be 103. Anion gap is high, 142 minus 87 plus 16, that is 103. Anion gap is somewhere like 39. So it is, there is a HAGMA respiratory acidosis, HAGMA plus respiratory acidosis. Now I gave you a clue. You have to look at the disease. So in Bartter's, you expect what? You expect some other metabolic problem also, right? So another clue is in HAGMA, what else you have to calculate? So I have always told you in HAGMA, you have to calculate delta ratio also. So now please calculate the delta ratio and give the complete answer. So HAGMA plus respiratory acidosis, completely agree with that, but the answer is not complete. So in HAGMA, you have to calculate the delta ratio. So excellent. So there is a, so in Bartter's, we expect metabolic alkalosis, right? Bartter is like Lasix. Bartter is like furosemide. You expect metabolic alkalosis with hypokalemia, with hypomagnesemia, right? So So all most of you rightly pointed that there is an acute respiratory acidosis, there is a metabolic acidosis, and there is a HAGMA anion gap HAGMA. Now the answer is not complete here. You have to look for delta ratio. So the delta anion gap was 39, delta anion gap was 27. So 27 delta bicarb was 9. So delta ratio was 3. So that means that this patient has a hidden metabolic alkalosis also. So the complete answer is metabolic alkalosis, which was the underlying disorder. On top of that, patient developed HAGMA and respiratory acidosis. That will be the complete answer for this patient. So now somebody has asked me about to explain the compensation limit again. So I will explain it again. So in a metabolic problem, so for example, in a metabolic acidosis, you expect change in CO2, you expect decrease in CO2, right? So that compensation in CO2, whatever way body try, it cannot go less than 10. So if the CO2 go less than 10 in a example in a DKA patient, it means that patient is having encephalopathy and patient is hyperventilating. The same way in a cystic fibrosis patient with metabolic alkalosis, whatever way the body try to compensate, the CO2 should not go above 60. If the CO2 is going above 60, it means that the patient is, it's not just compensation alone, the patient is having respiratory acidosis also, right? The same way in a respiratory acidosis scenario, you know that body will try to increase the bicarbonate, but that compensation alone cannot take bicarbonate above 40. If the bicarbonate goes above 40, that means that there is a metabolic concomitant metabolic alkalosis. So that is what you call compensation limit. Now, I'll just one more thing I will clarify. Some people were asking doubt about uncompensated. Okay. So just I'm trying to explain one more thing. We'll take one scenario, example of a metabolic acidosis patient. For example, pH 7.20. The bicarbonate is, I'm just taking roughly 15. Okay. So expected CO2 is somewhere around 20. And now you find that CO2 is 23, somewhere like this, 23 like this. So there are the simple way of interpreting this is, okay. Simple way of interpreting is expected CO2 is 20. Our normal body CO2 is 40. Body has tried to compensate, but body has not reached 20, has reached only 23. So the simplest way will be it is a partially compensated. Okay. So this is a traditional way of calling this pretty partially compensated metabolic acidosis, right? Now, some people can argue with me that here actually, if you goes by the Winter's formula, you get a range, right? Like plus minus 2. You get a range. So if you go by the Winter's formula, just imagine it is somewhere something like 20 plus or minus or 21 plus or minus 2. So you can argue with me that this 23 is in the range. So that is another way. Then it was, you can argue that it is almost compensated. Okay. But for analytical purpose, you need to remember a single value and give a single interpretation. So that is why we call it partially compensated, or it was almost compensated. Okay. So if you take a range, even if it falls in the range, you can call it almost compensated. But the traditional way is partially compensated. Now, why this happens is because even in respiratory compensation, that is in a metabolic scenario, the respiratory compensation, though we tell that it happens almost very fast, in practically does not happen like that. The compensation happens over few hours, right? So if you take a ABG within one of the insult, it will be like partially compensated. So the correct way to call that will be partially compensated. Now, you just remember this like that. Again, I think some people ask a doubt. the normal CO2 is 40, right? Now, the body tried to compensate and come down to 23. Okay, so what if the CO2 is 40 itself, there is no doubt. Or if the CO2 has gone above 40, there is no doubt that body hasn't compensated at all, or there is an underlying respiratory acidosis. Okay, if the CO2 goes above 40. Now, or if the CO2 is 40 itself also, there is no doubt. Okay. Now, some people can argue that even if the CO2 is 38, the body has not, body should have come, bring down to 23, but body is still at 38. So what you call, here, can there be underlying respiratory acidosis? So this is a little dicey situation. Okay. So that is why, in order to avoid confusion, so this kind of, if the CO2 is 38, we need to know the clinical scenario. For example, in a, I'm not trying to confuse you, in a metabolic acidosis, if you immediately take a ABG and you find that the CO2 is 38, I'm sure you can call it partially compensated, because body has not compensated, body has tried to compensate, it is partially compensated. But in a metabolic acidosis patient, one takes a ABG after 24 hours, okay, and then also you find that the CO2 is 38, then it might be possible that that patient has also a respiratory acidosis. So for that, you need to have a complete picture of the complete clinical scenario you need to have. So in order to avoid that confusion, you better stick to the basics of remembering single values. Okay. So if you get a range, you get confused whether it is compensated or uncompensated. So for that, you take single value, even for, not only for interpreting pH, so remember 7.44 pH, 40 for CO2, 24 for bicarbonate, anion gap 12, and for compensation also, you try to take single value by using 1.2, 0.6, 1, 2, 3, 4, try to take the single value and put an interpretation, whether the patient has reached that single value. If the patient has tried to compensate and hasn't reached that single value, it is partial compensation. If the patient has crossed that, or if the patient has not tried at all, then it is a mixed disorder, right? I think I have answered all the doubts. If there is any doubts, you can ask. I will wait for 10 more minutes. Yeah, so Dr. Pooja has asked that if the pH is normal and there is a mixed disorder, how to identify the primary pathology? That's an excellent question. So for that, you will need to know the clinical history. So you don't interpret a ABG in isolation. You always interpret with respect to the clinical scenario. For example, so you... For example, a cystic fibrosis patient. So you know that that patient is bound to have respiratory acidosis, right? So the primary could be respiratory. Now you have compensated metabolic, something like that. So in a mixed disorder with a normal pH, you need to know what was the primary. You need to know the history for the complete interpretation and identify what was the primary pathology. Yeah, so if the history not is not given, the complete interpretation with a primary, with a normal pH would not be possible. Okay, any other doubts? The YouTube link will be shared. Somebody are asking again about delta gap. I have tried to explain in the simplest way possible. So you just watch the YouTube link and I just see how I have explained the delta ratio more than one, or more than one, 1 to 2 will be normal. If what if it less than one? If the concept is difficult to understand, just remember delta ratio less than one means that there is a hidden magma. If the delta ratio more than two, it means that there is a hidden metabolic alkalosis. So most of the people try to by heart that. but I tried to explain the concept behind that. So if you understand the concept, all these things are easy. Now, I tried to, so somebody has asked me to explain the plateau pressure. So I'll just explain that and I will stop. Okay. So the plateau pressure means, again, imagine airway and the lungs, or the straw and balloon analogy. You are giving a pressure here. You first you have to overcome the straw, then you have to overcome the lung pressure. So the total pressure needed is peak inspiratory pressure or peak airway pressure. Now, when you reach a low flow, no flow state, when you put an inspiratory hold, you get the pressure what you is needed to inflate the lung alone. That is called the plateau pressure or the lung pressure. So this is the pressure needed to inflate the lung alone, or this indicate the lung pressure, or it is related to the compliance. So this is the plateau pressure. This is the peak inspiratory pressure. The difference here will be the airway pressure or transairway pressure. So if the airway pressure increases, it means that there is some pathological resistance in the airway, which you see in the asthma. If the plateau pressure increases, this means that the lung is stiff, or you need more pressure to inflate the lung, that is pneumonia or ARDS, right? So with this, I think, so I'm giving you my WhatsApp number and my mail. I always welcome queries from my students, and for feedback and queries, you can note down this mobile number, or this WhatsApp number and email ID, and you can send me feedback or queries. Last time in that show class center, I got some 5 to 10 queries, and I tried to give most of them the answers. Same way you can do with this also. So it is not a magic understanding the ABCs, just takes a little practice. So with this understanding, whenever you get a ABG in front of you, try to interpret it and practice it, and it will be easier for you. I think we will stop here. Thank you all for the patient listening.